Maple Leaf Audio presents They Disappeared by Rick Mofina, narrated by Andy Paris.
Chapter 1. New York City. This trip is going to change us forever, Jeff Griffin thought, as the jet descended into LaGuardia. He looked at his son, Cole, age 9, excited to be on his first plane and marveling at Manhattan's skyline, poking through the clouds. Then Jeff glanced at his wife, Sarah, at her hand, her wedding ring. Until a year and a half ago, they had been living a perfect life in Montana, where Jeff was a mechanic and a volunteer firefighter, and Sarah was a schoolteacher. They'd come to New York for Cole, because he'd always dreamed of seeing Manhattan. It seemed like the best thing to do, given all that they'd been through. "It's always going to be hard for us, Jeff," Sarah had told him. "But we just can't give up." While Sarah lived in hope, Jeff couldn't help but think that this vacation to New York was a requiem for the life they once lived. The landing gear locked into position with a hydraulic thud. Jeff exhaled slowly and turned to Cole.
"Wow, Dad, this is so great. I can't believe we're really doing this."
Jeff looked at Sarah. She gave him the promise of a smile, and he held on to it, thinking that maybe, just maybe, he should reconsider. After their plane landed, the Griffins moved through the arrival gate and joined the rush of passengers heading to the baggage claim area. The air smelled like industrial carpet cleaner and pretzels. Cole was energized by the bustling terminal as they made their way to the crowds at the carousels. Sarah went to the restroom while Jeff and Cole got their bags. Jeff shouldered his way to the conveyor, plucked Sarah's red bag from it, then his own. Cole had followed him and hefted his backpack from the carousel. Sarah had bought a new one for him, for the trip.
"Looks like the one." Jeff gave it a quick inspection, black with white trim and mesh side pockets.
He glanced quickly at the blue name tag without really reading it. Blue was the right color for the tag. Then he helped Cole get his arms through the straps. As they waited for Sarah, Cole tried counting all the carousels in their area, but there were too many. He loved the blurring pace as people jostled to heave their luggage onto trolleys before wheeling them out through the main doors.
"I wish Mom would hurry up, Dad. Can we see the Empire State Building from here?"
"Maybe on the cab ride to the hotel. There's Mom."
"All set." Sarah smiled, joining them.
They left the terminal through the automatic doors. Jeff spotted a row of news boxes. They reminded him that the travel agent had mentioned that a major event would be taking place when they were to arrive. The headlines shouted about it. "UN, whole world in the city again," said the Daily News. "Tighter security for world leaders means gridlock for all," blared the New York Post. As they queued up for a taxi in the ground transportation pickup zone, they didn't notice that among the throng of arriving passengers, one man had taken an interest in Cole. He was in his late 20s, a slender build with wild blonde hair. His face was void of emotion. He looked European, a youngish student bohemian traveler. As he walked by them, slowly and unseen, his attention locked onto Cole's bag. The man hesitated. The Griffins got into their cab. He stopped and watched, his face suddenly darkening with concern as they drove off. His backpack was black with white trim and mesh side pockets. It was identical to Cole's backpack. Chapter 2. New York City. Their taxi merged onto the Grand Central Parkway, and the driver lifted his head to his rearview mirror, which had a rosary hanging from it.
"Welcome to the capital of the world. Where are you coming in from?"
"Montana,"
Jeff said. Cowboys and land spreading out to the mountains, the driver said. That's right. Is this your first time to the Big Apple? No, I've been here for a few conventions over the years, and Jeff glanced at Sarah. We were here together a long, long time ago. Well, you picked a good time to return. Why's that? Jeff asked. We got the president and about 100 world leaders coming into town over the next few days for the UN meeting. Lots of security, sirens and helicopters. Messes up traffic. Yeah, we saw that in the newspapers.
The president and helicopters? Wow, Cole said.
It's a huge show and a glorious pain. The road clicked under the taxi's wheels as they moved onto the Brooklyn Queens Expressway. Sarah looked out her window at the endless flow of apartment buildings, warehouses, factories, and billboards. One showed a laughing baby's face next to a smiling young woman in a graduation cap, and she thought of their daughter, Leanne. They were moving west toward the Midtown Tunnel when they came to a gently sloping segment. The tip of the Empire State Building emerged in the haze ahead as Manhattan's skyline rose before them.
Look at that. I gotta take a picture, Cole said.
Oh, no, Mom. I put my camera in my backpack and it's in the trunk. That was dumb. Oh, no. Here, use mine. Sarah fished her small digital camera from her bag. Cole, a technical master, clenched an eye, took a photo, and showed his parents.
Oh, this is awesome, Cole said.
Moments later, the taxi slowed. An overhead freeway sign guided three lanes to the great stone mouth of the Midtown Tunnel. Lines of traffic moved through the toll gates. The tunnel gleamed in brilliant orange and yellow as it curved under the East River to Manhattan. Cole took more pictures until they surfaced somewhere near 40th Street and 3rd Avenue. As they looked at the skyscraper-lined canyons and the shining high-rise condos, Jeff's cell phone rang. The call was a 646 area code, with a number he didn't recognize. Hello? He heard nothing, and after several seconds of static, he hung up. Who was that? Sarah asked. Wrong number, I guess. Jeff shrugged. The sidewalks were a bazaar of action, with streams of people hurrying, waving at taxis amid sirens, horns. Steam plumes curled from the hot dog stands. People panhandled and street merchants argued with delivery truck drivers, while motorists screamed at jaywalkers who blocked streets. They were a world away from Laurel, Montana. Their hotel, the Central Suites Inn, was on West 29th Street in the 200 block, not far from Madison Square Garden. They checked into their 12th floor room. It was large, with two double beds. I need to freshen up, Sarah said. All right, Cole and I will unpack and get changed, Jeff said. Then we can go out for dinner and maybe walk to the Empire State Building. Cole claimed the bed nearest to the window. He unzipped his backpack at the foot of it and dumped its contents. T-shirts, shorts, a chocolate bar, a bag of potato chips, maps of New York, a hoodie, and socks fell out of it. All of it was unfamiliar, especially the man's shaving kit. Mom? Dad? Cole said. Sarah set her things down and surveyed the heap. Oh, for goodness sake, he's got the wrong bag. She inspected the backpack. The luggage claim barcode was torn. The blue name tag was faded and smudged. I thought you guys checked this. It looks exactly like Cole's bag. Jeff looked it over. A little, but the zippers are different. What are we gonna do, Mom? Cole said. I need my stuff. We'll call the airline. Don't worry, honey. Sarah pulled a printed page from her bag and went to the room's desk. See, I put this paper inside all our bags. It has our hotel and cell phone numbers, so whoever has your bag can call us. While Sarah and Jeff searched their airline tickets for a lost luggage number, Cole turned to the strange belongings. One item drew his interest. a tiny plastic toy jet. He pushed a small button on top of it. Lights flashed, and it made a jet engine sound. Cole loved it. He moved behind the curtains, pressed the toy against the window, taking it on a flight over Manhattan's tall buildings. "I can't find the claim number on my part of the ticket," Sarah said just as Jeff's cell phone rang. "Hey." Jeff looked at the display before he answered. "It's the same number that tried to call me when we were in the taxi."
"Mr. Griffin? Jeff Griffin? Of Laurel, Montana?"
"Yes."
"This is Hans Beck. I tried calling you earlier. I got your number from your backpack. I have it. There was a mix-up at the airport, and I was hoping you'd have mine. It looks just like yours. It has some clothes, snacks, maps, and my razor inside."
"Yes, we have it."
"Good. Can we trade them as soon as possible? I'm running late for a train. According to your information, you're at the Central Suites, that's near Penn Station."
"Yes, we can exchange the bags now if you like." Jeff nodded to Sarah, who smiled with relief and indicated that she would take a quick shower. After a few more minutes, Jeff had worked out the bag trade with the caller. "Cool. Let's go get your backpack, son." Startled by his dad, Cole, who'd been running the plane up and down the curtain, let the toy slip to the lower end as he pushed the curtain aside.
"Really?" Cole stepped from the window. "Now?"
"Yes, really. Yes. Now. So put all that stuff back in the bag. Everything, and let's go." Jeff had unfolded a map on his bed and studied it. "The guy who's got your backpack is going to meet us now, so move it." Overjoyed at getting his possessions back, Cole forgot about the plane and gathered all the items as fast as he could, shoving them hastily into the backpack while his dad glanced at the map. This Hans Beck had a German-sounding accent. Maybe he was a student, Jeff thought, as he and Cole walked toward Madison Square Garden with his backpack. They were to meet in front of a diner on 33rd Street across from Penn Station. Beck said he was 29, 5'11", with blonde hair. Jeff gave a description of himself and Cole, noting that they would also recognize each other by the backpacks. About 20 minutes after Beck had called, they spotted him on the street at the appointed location. Beck's hair was unkempt, his clothes disheveled. He was dragging anxiously on a cigarette, his face taut. "This guy's either on drugs or under some sort of pressure," Jeff thought. "Are you Hans Beck?" Beck blew a stream of smoke skyward and nodded. "Jeff and Cole Griffin." They traded handshakes, then backpacks. Immediately, Beck began rummaging through his.
"Everything's here, right?"
Beck said, snapping his head around at the sound of car horns from the traffic. "Sure. We didn't take anything, if that's what you mean," Jeff said.
"No, no, man."
Beck focused on Cole, then winked.
"Because you're too young to use my electric razor, right?"
"That's funny," Cole said. "The airplane you have in there is cool."
"What airplane?"
"You looked inside?"
"Sorry."
Cole glanced at his dad, then at Beck.
"It was when I thought it was my backpack. I saw the little toy plane."
"Everything's in there," Jeff said.
"What? Oh, okay. I'm really late."
Beck looked around to the street, closed the bag, then hoisted it onto his back.
"Yes, I packed it so fast, I'm not sure what I put in there. Well, I have to split. Thanks."
Beck disappeared into the crowds, entering Penn Station. Jeff's attention followed him with a ping of unease before he turned to Cole.
"Let's get back to the hotel, son."
Chapter 3. New York City. Hans Beck gripped his backpack and pinballed through Penn Station. For a fleeting moment, he considered boarding a train, any train, and getting away. No use. They're watching, waiting, and I need the money.
Beck had lied to Jeff Griffin about having to catch a train. Instead, he had to meet his contact and complete this delivery. He'd nearly blown this job. How could he have been so stupid to have picked up the wrong bag? In his time as a courier, he'd never screwed up like this. His customers were enraged. He'd never had contact so intense. He didn't know who they were or what they were involved in. He didn't want to know. When he'd given them the Griffin backpack in error, they took no comfort in his assurance he would retrieve the misplaced bag. Well, he did it, just as he said he would. So everyone should relax, he told himself. We've got the right bag now. Soon this would be over, and he'd be on a plane to Aruba, awaiting a large deposit in a numbered account. Beck left Penn Station and hurried by the post office and deep into the heart of the Hudson Yards. He moved quickly beyond the Long Island Railroad maintenance tracks, where 33rd Street dipped into a wasteland near the Hudson River. He was nearly jogging now, as he hurried along a chain-link fence that surrounded a site where a massive foundation, reaching down several stories, was under construction. The sun had set. The entire area was deserted. He heard the hum of a motor, then brakes, and a panel van stopped suddenly beside him. A side door slid open, and he got in. It was crowded inside, because several men were in the back working. A couple of them were talking on cell phones. Two others were working quickly on laptops. The men had already acted on the information sheet they'd found in Cole Griffin's bag and had quickly searched the family. They'd also taken pictures of Jeff and Cole on the street, making the exchange with Beck. Everything had unfolded with urgency. The men seized his backpack, dumped its contents, probed them, then tore through the empty backpack. Whatever they needed was still missing. For the first and last time in his life, Beck had failed to make a delivery. His final thought was that a plastic bag had swallowed his head, and his struggle against the forces holding him was in vain. Everything went black. His corpse was wrapped in a plastic sheet and hefted into the construction site. It was concealed under a layer of gravel at the base of a footing that would be filled with 50 cubic yards of concrete the next day. Chapter 4. New York City. The next morning, the Griffins went down to the lobby for breakfast. The dining area was crammed, but Sarah spotted a table for them. Jeff and Cole moved with the crowd along the breakfast bar, loading their trays with sausages, eggs, cereal, fruit, toast, juice, and coffee. Jeff saw Sarah at the table with her phone, reading, then responding to a text message. Who is she talking to? It consumed him as they ate and discussed options for the day, but he'd have to deal with it later. Cole was wearing a New York Jets t-shirt and ball cap they'd bought the night before, along with his new souvenir New York key ring bearing his name. He'd clipped it on the belt loop of his jeans. After flipping through his guidebook, Cole decided he wanted to take a tour bus down to Ground Zero, then a ferry to the Statue of Liberty. But can we go to Times Square first? He asked. There's a giant screen there that takes your picture, and a toy store with a Ferris wheel inside. Can we go there? Jeff consulted his map of New York.
Are you up for a walk?
You bet. And every time I see the Empire State Building, I'm taking more pictures. Can I go back for another juice, Mom?
Sure.
When they were alone, Jeff nodded to Sarah's phone.
So, who were you talking to?
Valerie, back home. She was asking if we got in okay.
Valerie? Anybody else?
Jeff, please don't do this.
Who, Sarah?
Her face reddened. She was on the verge of losing it with him. Instead, she seized her phone, queued the message, then thrust it at him. Valerie, see? Valerie.
Sorry,
Sarah put a hand to her mouth, blinking back tears. She looked toward the food bar to see Cole waiting his turn to fill his glass at the juice dispenser. She looked at Jeff. On our way in from the airport, I saw this billboard, and she halted, shifted her thought. I don't want a divorce, and I don't think this is the time or place to tell Cole that you want one. We can't break his heart, Jeff. We have to hang on and work this out. He noticed she was twisting her wedding ring. I never blamed you for what happened, she said. I was out of my mind. We both were. I was angry, but I never blamed you for what happened. Get this through your head. I love you. We have to fight to hold this family together, not tear what's left of it apart. Please. Upon seeing Cole returning, she dropped her voice to a whisper. Why in God's name can't you see that? Jeff looked at her without speaking, his mind racing with a million thoughts before Cole returned, sensing unease. Are you okay, Mom? She touched a tissue to her eyes. Just a sad memory, sweetie. All right. Jeff cleared his throat and stood with his tray to clear the table. Let's get going. They walked east to 7th Avenue, then Broadway bound for Times Square. The city pulsated under a clear sky with the thud of a passing helicopter, the ever-present wail of sirens and traffic telling him that he had to come to a decision. It weighed on him as they moved north along Broadway. Here, amid the whirlwind, he considered Sarah's words. We have to fight to hold this family together. We have to hang on and work this out. Was she right? Dad, are you going to get in the picture with Mom now? Cole's question pulled Jeff from his thoughts, and he took an immediate assessment, estimating that they were somewhere around 44th and 45th Streets, near 7th Avenue. The streets were crowded. Traffic was heavy. Not far from where they stood, massive neon signs soared in spectacular glory, exuding an air of controlled chaos. News reports flowed nonstop in electronic ribbons of light that wrapped around several buildings. They were at the edge of Times Square. Sarah had just taken Cole's picture and returned her camera to him. Over there, Dad, Cole said from behind the viewfinder. Get next to Mom. I want to get that big flashy sign behind you. Then we'll go down to the center of Times Square. Hurry! Jeff put his arm around Sarah, then felt her arm solidly around his waist. It felt good. It felt right. And a bittersweet sensation rolled over him. He couldn't remember the last time they'd touched each other, held each other. This wasn't easy. They both made an effort to disguise the emotional turmoil churning under the smiles they manufactured for Cole. Finally, he took the shot. All right, he said. Can we get one of all of us together? Let me ask somebody, Jeff said. He took the camera from Cole and went a few yards down the crowded sidewalk to an older man wearing a Yankees ball cap taking photos of two women, likely his wife and daughter. Jeff asked him if he would mind taking a Griffin family photo with Sarah's camera. Be happy to. The man took the picture, but when Cole requested he take one more, nothing happened with the camera. The man looked at it. Looks like your batteries are gone. The man handed it back. Jeff thanked him and turned to Cole and Sarah. I forgot to put in fresh ones, Sarah said. It's okay. Jeff glanced around, spotting a suitable store behind them. I'll go in there and get fresh batteries. You stay right here. Don't go anywhere. All right, Sarah said. She and Cole began inspecting the jewelry, statues, artwork, and t-shirts on a vendor's cart. Jeff stepped toward the store but was stopped. Sir, could you spare any change for a veteran? A man with bushy dark hair and a beard flecked with bits of something white held up a hand in a dirty, worn cyclist glove. He was in a wheelchair and missing his right leg. He wore torn jeans, a filthy John Lennon t-shirt,
and a tattered raincoat. His chair was reinforced with metal coat hangers and had a U.S. flag affixed to it. Jeff looked into his leathery, weather-worn face, his brown eyes, and figured him to be in his early 30s. Guys who served deserved better, Jeff thought. How'd you lose your leg?
IED in Afghanistan. I ain't had a decent meal in days, sir.
Jeff thrust his hand into his pocket and pulled out two crumpled fives. Here. The man stared at the cash.
Thank you. God bless you and your beautiful family there, sir.
Jeff went to the store. Metro Manhattan gifts and things. It had a narrow storefront of soot-streaked stone and a large window cluttered with a galaxy of tacky items. Discounts on jewelry, t-shirts, and posters were listed on the chalkboard sign outside. Inside, rock music throbbed from a radio station. The walls were jammed with t-shirts, ball caps, trinkets, posters, knickknacks. A young man was on a ladder, pulling down a cardboard box overflowing with scarves for two women. Racks filled with chips, chocolate bars, and snack cakes bordered one side of the store, next to coolers filled with soda, juices, and water. Compact video recorders, cell phones, and other electronics covered the wall behind the counter near the cash. A mounted security camera watched from above. Jeff took his place in line behind a half a dozen customers. As he waited, he saw Sarah and Cole through the window, browsing at the cart. They looked happy, and the image sent his mind racing back to that last moment of perfection. Back to that time when he'd sat in his truck in the driveway and watched Sarah with Cole and their baby daughter Leanne through the window. The last time they were happy. And now he'd brought his family here, to the brink of disintegration. Kransky the Shrink had been right. They couldn't just overcome the blow of Leanne's death. They had to adapt to it and allow each other to deal with it in their own way. Throughout their ordeal, Cole had been the rock of the family. He'd accepted that God had made his baby sister an angel and took her to heaven first to wait for them. Cole just got on with being a kid and continued obsessing about seeing New York City the way most kids obsessed about seeing Disney World. In this way, Cole was the calm, healing force holding them all together against the threat of destruction. And the threat wasn't Sarah. It's me. After all this time, Jeff realized that he'd failed to accept how Sarah dealt with her own grief and guilt. She blamed herself for being 340 miles away when their baby died. Jeff blamed himself for being in the next room asleep. He had been so numbed and blinded by his anger, his guilt, that he let it give way to paranoia, thinking wrongly that Sarah had turned to another man for comfort. He let it all reach the point where it was tearing them apart. What have I done? Standing in line, waiting to buy batteries, it dawned on him. Maybe it had started when he felt Sarah's arm around him tight. But when the truth hit, it hit him like a freight train. Sarah was not cheating on him. She did not hate him. What he was doing was wrong. The last thing he wanted was to separate. He agreed with Sarah. When their baby girl died, they went out of their minds with grief. They'd both been consumed with guilt and anger over losing her. He replayed Sarah's plea. We have to fight to hold this family together. We have to hang on and work this out. She was right. They'd been through enough. Suddenly, Jeff felt like a man waking up. How could I have been so stupid? It was his turn at the counter, and the clerk at the register, a girl in her 20s with a diamond stud in her left nostril, fuchsia streaks in her dyed white hair and tattoos on her arms, smiled as she chewed gum and bobbed her head to an old David Bowie song. I need some batteries. What size? AA, I think. Wait, let me check. sorry. Horn blasts from the street competed with the music inside as Jeff opened the battery compartment. It took him 3 attempts. The clerk snapped her gum and eyed the other customers while she waited. Patience in New York came at a premium. "Yes, double A," he said. "Better give me 3 of those 4-packs. She slapped them on the counter. "Here you go." Jeff paid. He returned to the street, ready to tell Sarah that he'd come to his senses. This trip would change everything. For the better. He went to the vendor's cart, but they weren't there. He looked up and down the street. No sign of Sarah and Cole. What's going on? They must have gone into a store, he thought, and entered the nearest one, a crowded retail sportswear outlet. Inside, he searched the packed aisle, scanning the shoppers for Sarah and Cole. He glimpsed a flash of green, the back of a boy's New York Jets t-shirt, as it disappeared behind a display of jackets. There's Cole. Jeff hurried after him, ready to scold Sarah for vanishing, but he stopped cold. The boy was not Cole. Jeff took immediate stock of the surroundings. No sign of Sarah and Cole. He hurried out and rushed into the next business, a crowded deli where he again took swift inventory. Again, he found no trace of his wife and son. He moved on, searching in vain. He stood on the sidewalk and scoured the storefronts across the street, but it was futile. Jeff couldn't find Sarah and Cole. Then, above all the crowds, the traffic, the noise, and the confusion, he heard the first high-pitched ring in the back of his mind. It shot to his gut, where disbelief battled his fear, that maybe something was wrong. Chapter 5. New York City. Jeff scanned the crowds, threading his way a few yards in one direction, then a few yards in another. Sarah? He looked up and down the street. They disappeared. He reached for his cell phone and called Sarah's number. This is nuts. Where'd they go? It rang several times before going to her voicemail. Hey, you disappeared on me, Jeff said. Where are you? I'm standing by the souvenir cart. He studied the nearest storefronts again. A sports store, an electronics store, a ticket seller, a place fronted with plywood that was under renovation. Had they gone into one? Which one would they enter? He wasn't sure. He told them not to move. Did Sarah even hear her phone ring? He called her number again. Again, he got her voicemail. He scrutinized the street. Faces blurred as streams of people dissolved into chaotic rivers and the smells of perfume, sweat, and grilled spicy meat. Human features became indistinguishable as people brushed against him, bumped him. Are you looking for your wife and son? Jeff turned around to the man in the wheelchair, the man to whom he'd given $10. Yes. Did you see them? I think they got picked up. Picked up? What do you mean? Well, I saw it from the corner of my eye. I wasn't focused on it, but it looked like 2 guys picked them up.
What 2 guys?
2 guys sort of helped them into a van or an SUV, and they drove off.
What are you talking about?
It happened real fast, like everyone was in a hurry.
Where?
Right there. He nodded to the spot where Jeff had left them.
Nothing was making sense.
Jeff shook his head. I doubt that. My wife wouldn't go with anyone. She doesn't know anyone in New York. It looked like they were pulling your boy, and your wife was trying to stop them, and then they took her, too. It was real fast and smooth.
What? Well, that's crazy.
I'm telling you what I saw. Hold on. Jeff went to the ponytailed man selling souvenirs from the cart where Sarah and Cole had browsed moments ago.
The man was wearing a tie-dye t-shirt and dark glasses.
Who?
The man said after Jeff had explained. My wife and son. They were just here, looking at your card a few minutes ago. Did you see them go into a store? The ponytailed man scratched his 3-day growth, then shrugged.
Sorry, pal. It's hectic here, with people and traffic. People get picked up and dropped off around here every 2 seconds. I didn't see anything.
Jeff turned back to the wheelchair man.
I think you saw someone else, Jeff said. I think they're in a store.
No, it happened.
Did they say anything? Where they were going or who they were?
Sir, I don't know.
What about the vehicle? What color was it?
Silver, white. I'm not sure. White, yeah. Maybe white.
Jeff ran his hand through his hair, unable to dismiss his unease over what this wheelchair guy claimed to have seen. It just doesn't make any sense.
I think you're mistaken and that you saw someone else.
I know I saw it out of the corner of my eye, but listen to me. It happened. It didn't look right. I'm just telling you what I saw because you seem like a nice family. If you don't want to believe me, that's your choice.
The man clamped his hands on his wheels and rolled away.
No, Jeff thought. I don't want to believe you, because this can't be real.
Jeff took a quick breath, reached for his phone, and tried Sarah again. But before he pressed her number, he saw something small and shiny in the street near the curb. A key ring. Its clasp was open. He picked it up. It was looped to a miniature novelty blue and white New York license plate with a name on it. Cole. Cole's keyring. It was in the gutter, where it would have fallen if he'd gotten into a vehicle.
Oh, Christ, it's true. Oh, Jesus. No. My wife, my son, abducted from the street. Why? Who would do this? Why?
Jeff trembled at the absurdity, the horror, as he looked in every direction, searching for something, anything to subdue the wave of alarm rising around him. This was the edge of Times Square, the crossroads of the world. The concentration of people, the comings and goings, the enormity of it all, was dizzying. He pulled his fingers into a fist around Cole's keyring. Chapter 6. New York City. New York City police officers Jimmy Hodge and Roy Duggan were walking the beat, extended Times Square. Earlier that morning, at the top of their tour, they'd helped two other cops corner a perp after he'd tried to boost a Mercedes on 7th Avenue. Duggan happily let those two do the paperwork because he and Jimmy had good numbers this month. No danger of a white shirt breathing down their necks for stats. Now they were back on patrol, and a coffee break was overdue. Duggan, a third-generation uniform with 23 years on the street, was telling young Jimmy, his rookie partner of 4 months, about a deli on 47th, when a white guy in his 30s rushed up to them.
I need help.
Instinctively, Hodge and Duggan braced while giving him the instant head-to-toe. Worried demeanor, sweaty. 6 foot, medium build, muscular, clean cut, brown hair, jeans, golf shirt with Laurel, Montana Volunteer Fire Department insignia. Nothing in his hands but a cell phone.
What's the problem? Hodge asked.
My wife and son have been abducted.
Hodge traded a quick glance with Duggan.
Your wife and son?
Hodge reached for his notebook.
It happened a few minutes ago.
Take it easy. Let's start with some ID and names, Hodge said.
The man identified himself as Jeff Griffin, and Hodge started notes for a report.
Okay, Jeff, tell us what happened and where, Hodge asked.
The man walked them to the location, recounting the few details he had. Hodge took notes, asked short questions. Duggan said nothing. As their radios crackled with crosstalk, Duggan studied Jeff, listening, absorbing and watching through jaded brown eyes that seldom missed a thing.
nearly finished, Jeff turned to the wheelchair man, panhandling some 15 yards up the street. And that guy there in the wheelchair said he saw two men help them into a van or an SUV before it drove away.
"You got this from Freddy?"
Duggan said. "Is that his name? The soldier who lost his leg in Afghanistan? He said it didn't look right when he saw them being taken away."
"Freddy sees a lot of things," Duggan said.
Jeff nodded, clearly reassured he had a witness that police knew. But then Duggan elaborated.
"Sometimes Freddy sees things that aren't there, depending on whether he's on or off his meds. He didn't lose his leg overseas. He slipped at a subway station platform. Train crushed it.
Did you give him money?"
$10. He always tries to help people who give him money. He's not a bad person," Duggan said.
"What are you saying?" In the tense silence, Jeff looked hard at Duggan, then Hodge, sensing doubt. His face showed an oncoming rush of helplessness.
"What? You don't believe me? Christ, what am I supposed to do here?"
"Maybe it's like you said," Hodge offered. "Maybe they went into a store and Freddy got mixed up. Maybe you should wait a bit." Suddenly remembering his one piece of evidence, Jeff reached into his pocket, then held up Cole's keyring. "I found this in the street, right where they were. We got this for Cole yesterday. He'd clipped it to his pants this morning. You've got to help me." Duggan's face tightened as he blinked at Cole's keyring. His instinct, forged from 2 decades of police work, was now telling him that the situation had changed.
"All right, here's what we're gonna do," Duggan said. "I'll talk to Freddy. Jeff, give Officer Hodge any recent photos you have. We'll start a canvas with other uniforms, and I'll call a car for you, Jeff."
"Why?"
"This needs to go to the detective squad at Manhattan South."
Duggan talked into his walkie-talkie as he started toward Freddy. Jeff queued up the photos on his camera and sent them to Hodge's BlackBerry. He took more notes from Jeff, added more details. Then Hodge hit send. "I've just shot the information and pictures to every cop patrolling this area," Hodge said. Duggan returned from taking Freddy's information and was on his radio again, searching the traffic.
"Jimmy, email your notes for the 61 to Sergeant McBain. I'll call him."
"Jeff,"
Duggan nodded to the street. "Your ride's here."
A siren yelped, and a marked NYPD radio car, lights flashing, pulled over. Duggan leaned into the empty passenger section, had a quick conversation with the officer behind the wheel. Duggan then opened the rear door for Jeff, who saw Hodge huddling with 4 other uniformed officers who'd arrived.
"Jeff, this is Officer Brito. He's going to drive you to the station house," Duggan said. "He'll take you in to Sergeant McBain, who'll refer you to the detective squad. They'll take over. Here's my card with my cell and email. We have your information."
"Thank you."
"We're going to circulate and look for Sarah and Cole here while you work with the detectives. The squad at the 14th Precinct has more resources than we do. They'll decide what steps to take next."
"Okay. Thanks." Jeff got in the back. The seat, vinyl patched with duct tape, was separated from the front by a plastic divider. There was little legroom. The back windows were uptight and wouldn't open. The rear smelled of lemon-scented cleaner, barely masking the trace of vomit and despair. When Brito slid the divider open, Jeff welcomed the relief as breezes from the open front windows carried Brito's cologne to the back of the car.
"It's about 10 blocks away. I'll have you there in no time."
The siren yelped again, then wailed nonstop as Brito maneuvered the Crown Victoria through traffic. Jeff was no stranger to emergency vehicles. He took in the controls for the overhead lights, siren, public address, searchlights, the small computer terminal. Brito's police radio issued a never-ending stream of coded transmissions. Traffic ahead parted for them. "See?" Brito tapped his computer's monitor. Jeff saw Sarah and Cole's picture. "We're getting information out there." Jeff's gut writhed with relief and fear. Then he noticed the visor above Brito, where the faces of a woman and two girls around 3 or 4 years old smiled down from a color snapshot. "That your family in the picture above you?" "Those are my girls. Duggan says you're a firefighter in Montana." "Volunteer. I'm a mechanic." "My brother was a firefighter. We lost him in the towers."
"Sorry to hear that."
The siren wailed. Jeff tried Sarah's cell phone once more. Again, it was futile. "Hi, this is Sarah. Please leave a message." Keeping the phone pressed to his ear, he clung to her voice for a moment before another stab of concern hit him and he let go. Brito caught it and met him in the rearview mirror.
"Don't worry, Jeff. We're going to find your wife and son. Don't worry."
"Yeah. Thanks." He saw Brito's profile as he drove. Then, Jeff saw himself alone in the rearview mirror, stress lines carved in his face, worry bordering on fear clouding his eyes. "If this is a nightmare, then why can't I wake up? Wake up." Jeff got out Cole's keyring, then the camera, and looked at the last picture taken of the three of them together. He turned back to the window. Manhattan blurred by, and the siren rose to a near scream. Chapter 7. New York City. The 14th Precinct was situated on 35th Street between 8th and 9th Avenues in a three-story cream and coffee-colored building. Brito escorted Jeff to Sergeant McBain, a burly man on the north side of 50. He was studying his computer at his desk and paused to gaze at them over his bifocals when Brito introduced him. "Sarge, this is Jeff Griffin, Duggan and Hodges 61. McBain threw his attention to Jeff. "Did the officers find my wife and son?" Jeff asked. "Did they call in?"
"No, I'm afraid nothing's come in yet."
McBain removed his glasses to get a better read on Jeff.
"I've spoken to the patrol officers and looked at their notes. From what I understand, Mr. Griffin, your wife and son left with two men in a vehicle in an alleged abduction?"
"Nothing's alleged. They were taken. What's going on?"
"Nothing's going on, Mr. Griffin. We're opening an investigation. We'll do all we can to help you locate your wife and son."
McBain replaced his glasses and made a few strokes on his computer keyboard.
"All right, Detectives Cordelli and Ortiz will talk to you. Officer Brito will take you up to the squad."
As they headed upstairs, Jeff told Brito that he couldn't understand why everyone was skeptical when he needed their help.
"A lot of people mislead us," Brito said, "or change their story."
Arriving on the floor,
Brito led him down a hall to the fluorescent-lit squad room and a maze of government-issue metal desks.
The walls were lined with file cabinets and clipboards holding crime reports, crime stats, corkboards with maps, wanted posters, shift schedules. One schedule had huge block letters, UN Detail Shift. A large flat-screen TV mounted to the ceiling was tuned to an all-news channel reporting on the UN meeting. The area was abandoned, except for one guy in plain clothes hunched at his desk, talking loud on the phone. The day shift was out. Jeff's mind raced. Minutes ago, he was walking down the street with his family. Now here he was, walking through a police squad room. Brito stopped at two conjoined desks, then rolled over a cushioned swivel chair. "Have a seat. I'll find Cordelli and Ortiz." Jeff surveyed the desks. Their sides were pushed against a wall, under a well-used board displaying memos, calendars, and personal items. To the left, a framed degree from Long Island University for Juanita Ortiz. A newsletter photo of a beaming female cop in formal blues, receiving her shield under the headline, "Detective Second Grade." It was a snapshot of a man and woman with a little girl, about five, by a mountain lake. The girl had an orange butterfly on her finger. On the right side of the board, a framed degree in criminal justice for Victor Cordelli from St. Joseph's College. A framed autographed photo of a man with two members of the New York Yankees on either side. There was some kind of award for Detective Cordelli. First grade for exceptional duty in the NYPD Intelligence Division. No photos of a wife or kids. There was a card with an array of vulgar handwritten notes. "Hey Cordelli, condolences on 20 freaking years with the NYPD. Each desk had a computer monitor and keyboard. Here, Jeff saw file folders fanned over desks and notebooks bound with elastic and neatly stacked. On one of the desks was a splayed copy of the New York Daily News with the same headline he'd seen in the boxes a short time ago, while walking with Sarah and Cole from the hotel to where... Oh, Jesus. He ran his hand over his face. They just disappeared. They can't be gone. Who would do this? Why? Why aren't police rushing to search for them? Mr. Griffin? He turned to a woman in her mid-30s, tawny hair pulled into a ponytail. She wore a dark blazer, matching pants, white shirt, looked sharp. "Juanita Ortiz, and this is Vic Cordelli." Both detectives carried brimming coffee mugs, but managed firm grips when they shook his hand. He declined their offer of a drink. They sat down. Juanita turned to a fresh page in a new notebook. "I'm sorry, we just cleared another case last night," Ortiz said. "And we know you told the patrol officers everything, but we need you to tell us what happened." As Jeff recounted the morning, Cordelli leaned back in his chair. He was wearing jeans, a polo shirt, his ID and a shoulder holster, holding a gun. He had a goatee, was about Jeff's height, but was wiry and revving in a high gear. Sipping from his mug like he really needed it, Cordelli eyed him over the rim. After Jeff finished relating events, Cordelli asked to see Cole's keyring. "And you found this in the street where you last saw them?" "Yes." Cordelli turned it over in his hand a few times before returning it. Then he asked to see all the pictures in Sarah's camera and immediately downloaded them to his computer. From his vantage, Jeff could partially see the photos as Cordelli scrutinized them one by one, and Ortiz continued the interview. "Jeff, will you volunteer all information about credit, bank, and cell phones you and Sarah use?" she asked. "Of course." He pulled out his wallet. "If this is a robbery," she said while recording account numbers, "we'll track charges, withdrawals, maybe get photos from an ATM, that sort of thing. It helps."
"Is that what you think happened?"
"It's one theory," Ortiz said.
"If the men wanted to rob them, wouldn't they have let them go by now? God, they could be doing anything to them."
"Take it easy. At this point," Cordelli said, "we're not sure what this is."
Jeff's breathing quickened. Was there something he was overlooking or forgetting? One by one, images from the morning flowed across Cordelli's monitor. The street. Cole. Sarah. Haunting Jeff as he turned back to Ortiz, who went over her notes. She asked a spectrum of questions, probing a little deeper about Sarah, her job, her disposition, family medical conditions, and family history.
Jeff told her everything, but withheld mention of Leanne and its toll.
It was too painful, entangled with his own guilt and irrelevant as far as he was concerned. "What about my wife's cell phone?" Jeff asked. "I read somewhere that you guys can track cell phones, that there's technology to pinpoint where people are through their cell phone." "Sometimes," Cordelli said. "May I see your phone?" Cordelli turned it on, expertly buttoned and scrolled through its menu and functions. "Is your wife's phone similar?"
"It's the same."
"These are older models. The tracking ability you're talking about is limited on this type."
Cordelli returned Jeff's phone and went back to studying the photos, adding,
"And as for tracking roaming signals, the phone has to be turned on. Even then, we need warrants to get the phone companies to release that information, but we can expedite them."
"Is there something else you can do with the phone?"
"We can get a warrant to essentially clone your phone."
"What does that mean?"
"Any calls, texts, downloads, received or sent, will also come to us, to a special line with the NYPD, without the caller or sender being aware. It's like a tap. It allows us to be on top of any communication that might come from the bad guys, say a ransom call, or if your wife or son got to a phone and called for help.
And we'll work with FBI for warrants on your hotel or home and work phones in Montana. All numbers associated directly with you or your wife, in case any calls go there."
"I want you to do everything that helps, yes."
"We want to be prepared," Cordelli said. "But the bad guys are smart. They toss the victims' phones. And they use prepaid disposables that are virtually impossible to track."
Hans Beck.
"Wait. There was a mix-up with Cole's bag at LaGuardia. I got a call from this guy, Hans Beck. We had his backpack, he had ours, and we met near Penn Station late yesterday and traded them."
"Anything you can remember about him?"
Jeff described Beck and explained how he'd obtained Jeff's cell phone number. Ortiz made notes.
"He was kind of weird, nervous," Jeff said. "His number's on my phone."
Cordelli displayed the call list. Jeff pointed to it.
"Did he threaten you, ask for money?" Cordelli asked.
"No."
"How was he weird?"
"I don't know. He seemed preoccupied, like something was on his mind. Maybe it was because he was rushed. He said he had to catch a train."
"Did you see what was in his bag? Drugs? Anything unusual?"
Jeff shook his head, and Cordelli and Ortiz exchanged glances.
"He could have targeted your family for a robbery or ransom," Cordelli said.
"Or it could be nothing."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.